BBC Sounds. Music, radio, podcasts.
Hello, and thank you for listening to Analysis, the podcast that looks at the ideas behind the news. In this edition, James Ball looks at whether the infrastructure of the internet is up to scratch.
It's a sunny morning in Portsmouth, and I'm here to look at the internet. The internet has grown into a vital piece of infrastructure. It's a cornerstone of our economy, central to our personal and professional lives, and the software on which society increasingly runs. And when we think about the internet, we might imagine it as a floating cloud, or a ginormous bank of servers, or complicated strings of code. What we probably don't imagine are cables the width of a hose pipe not far from here off the coast of Portsmouth. The internet works very differently from how we might expect, both its physical infrastructure and the rules that govern it. I'm James Ball, journalist and author of The System, Who Owns the Internet and How It Owns Us. And in this week's analysis, I'm asking whether the internet's up to scratch. And if it's not, then what does that mean for us?
There's this perception that our transatlantic or international communications still go via satellites. The submarine telecommunications industry is one of the, I think, the best kept secrets in the world.
The internet doesn't only come in and out of the UK near Portsmouth, but all along the British coast, from Cornwall to Blackpool to Norfolk. These cables are installed and maintained by companies like Global Marine Systems, where Bruce Nielsen-Watts is managing director.
You could be looking down from the sky, say, like the, you know, the Spaghetti Junction north of Birmingham, and that's what, in some parts of the world, that is what the subsea infrastructure can look like.
If people are thinking about the sort of cables that go across the sea to carry the internet, I don't know, they're probably thinking of something the size of a sewer or a tube tunnel or that kind of thing. Would they be right?
No, I think the reality is you've got a cable that is probably no bigger than the thickness of your thumb that is sitting on the seabed out in the middle of the Atlantic or the Pacific, anywhere down to 4,000 or 5,000 metres depth of water. If you can imagine you're laying a cable across the Atlantic, it's like, you know, laying a cable across the top of the Himalayas. It's not flat. It goes up and down. You need to try and lay that cable as securely as possible.
A lot of painstaking research goes into getting these cables laid and repaired. They can be severed by anchors, dredged up by fishing boats, or even, on rare occasions, chewed through by sharks. If a cable breaks, there's usually a different route for the data to follow. But that's more difficult when disaster strikes on a larger scale.
The 2006 Boxing Day outage off Taiwan, so there was an earthquake off the southern coast of Taiwan. It was about somewhere between 6-10 kilometres deep, and that took out an awful lot of cables. And there was something like 22 individual cable faults, and those cables would service countries like Japan, Hong Kong, China, Philippines, Malaysia, Thailand, Indonesia and Singapore. And at the time, all those countries experienced a significant amount of outage.
Natural disasters so seismic they knock out a substantial amount of cables are mercifully rare. But the fact that it can happen at all reveals an important truth. Our connection to the internet, a service on which we increasingly rely, is more tenuous than we might think.
It's not until we see events like that that the fragility of the offshore infrastructure is recognised.
Unless sharks develop a taste for fibre optic cabling, physical damage is unlikely to pose a long-standing threat to our global internet connection. In fact, it's the rules that govern how data travels down these cables, the internet's logical infrastructure rather than physical, where some of the more intractable problems lie. To understand why, we need to go back to the late 1960s, because the earliest days of the internet have shaped how it works now and given rise to some of our contemporary challenges.
So my name is Steve Crocker. I was involved with the ARPANET at the very beginning of the internet period.
Steve Crocker was a computer engineer when the internet wasn't even called the internet. It was called the ARPANET, and it had its roots in the Cold War.
The Russians, who have a constant feeling of inferiority in the modern world, became terrifically...
The Russians sent Sputnik up in late 57 and caused a shockwave in the U.S. government.
This was one time they had beaten the West in all its propaganda about higher living standards. The Sputnik was something the Russians could now boast about, and they did.
In sharp reaction, an agency was put together at the top level of the Defense Department called the Advanced Research Projects Agency, ARPA, to make sure that there was no technological surprise in the future. And one of its offices was focused on information technology. So that office funded a lot of the basic computer science research projects. And after a couple of years, they decided that they would try to connect these laboratories together and build the basis of networking. So hence you have ARPANET.
Four different universities, UCLA, Santa Barbara, Stanford Research Institute, and Utah, became the first sites on the network. They were all linked by cables.
The core set of people who put the network together were familiar with each other. Some of us became friends. And one of the things that was put together relatively quickly was a directory of who was who at each of the sites and who to contact. And the reason for publishing those names was so they could contact each other to sort out operational problems if something didn't work.
In other words, when the ARPANET went down, if the cables didn't work or the computers crashed, they would phone each other up to fix it.
I don't think any of us viewed the ARPANET as the horse to ride, so to speak, for our careers. It was a bit of a sideshow, and certainly for me. And I thought, okay, well, we'll build this thing. It'll be useful. Everybody will get to use it. And then we'll go on and do some serious work. I've revised my thinking since then a little bit.
It was partly because no one could imagine what it would grow into that the engineers who worked on the network in the first place ensured that it was open. It meant anyone could create new tools and services, like email, say, or the web, and access those made by others.
We knew that we weren't going to be able to predict everything. We weren't building a product in the usual sense. We were building more of a toolkit.
For decades, the growth of the internet was very slow. And then, in the 90s, its popularity exploded.
Tonight, the information superhighway and one of its main thoroughfares, an online network called Internet.
The critical thing that happened in the 90s was the transition from academic networking to commercial networking.
What do President Clinton, conservative radio personality Rush Limbaugh, and rock star Billy Idol have in common? They've all got electronic mail addresses on computer systems linked to the internet.
And it wasn't until right around 1990 that things opened up and it was permitted to build commercial networks and interconnect them with the existing networks. And that opened up for virtually everything.
As the internet grew, it retained the same openness from when there were far fewer users, when you could still phone a friend if the network went down. Certain ideas that had been omitted in order to keep things technically simple, like recording users' identities or building in security, became bigger factors as the network grew. Cindy Cohen is executive director of non-profit digital rights group, the Electronic Frontiers Foundation.
The beauty of the internet is it kind of allows anybody to dig in, understand it, and build something on top of it. On the one hand, it's a good thing because it really does keep it available to all of us and it allows innovation. The downside of that is that there are some pretty important pieces of our infrastructure that are not really held together in the way that I think most of us would hope.
By the time the internet's evolution had gone into overdrive, the die had already been cast. And we now live with the consequences.
We all now, especially during the pandemic, realize how important it is that all of these pieces continue to work together. It's vital. You know, our children are educated over this. Our economy depends on it now more than ever. But the reality is that the internet is, especially at some of the deeper layers, some of it is really held together with baling wire and string, or maybe just one or two volunteers who help keep a system running.
So what exactly are these important pieces of infrastructure? One major innovation introduced by the people who first worked on the ARPANET was protocols, sets of rules that continue to govern our use of the internet today. Emily Taylor is CEO of Oxford Information Labs and an associate fellow at Chatham House.
Protocols are the things that we like to forget about because they're just in the background and they just work. But they are actually the foundational building blocks of the internet and all of the technologies that we're using every day. These have really stood the test of time because of their simplicity, their openness, their interoperability.
Although our experience of the internet is mostly of services provided by platforms like Google, Facebook, or Amazon, what connects us to these platforms are protocols. There are all sorts of internet protocols. They might decide how the website name you type directs you to a particular page online, or which cables data flows through across the Atlantic Ocean. The Border Gateway Protocol, or BGP, is one such protocol. Ross Anderson is a professor of security engineering at the University of Cambridge.
BGP, the Border Gateway Protocol, this goes back about 30 years to when the internet was starting to assume its present form before it became big time with the public.
It has an unusual origin story. The Border Gateway Protocol was literally written on the back of two napkins by some computer engineers at a tech conference in the 1980s, and it's still in use today. Your computer connects to the internet through a router, the little box at home that we sometimes shout swear words at. And this router is, as the name implies, looking for the best route, via internet cables, to send and receive data. BGP shows what routes are available. It works a bit like the transponders which help guide aeroplanes. These signal a plane is going in the right direction for, say, Paris, and so help guide them on their way. And yet, despite being fundamental to how the internet works, BGP can get tied in knots, as happened in 2008.
What happened was that the Pakistani government decided that they wanted to censor certain videos on YouTube.
The Pakistani government wanted to block access to a trailer for an anti-Islamic film, and they instructed Pakistan Telecom to signpost using BGP that they had a great route for YouTube.
Anybody in Pakistan who was trying to watch these wicked videos would instead be redirected to Pakistan Telecom's website, which would tell them not to be a naughty boy. However, they didn't announce this just locally to Pakistan, they announced it worldwide. And so for a short space of time, everybody who was trying to watch YouTube was being redirected to Pakistan and not getting the videos they wanted.
In this case, it was a mistake. But there is potential for more malign exploitation.
One of the cases that alarmed people was a case where China Telecom announced that it had a good route to an awful lot of the internet. And so for a number of minutes, it was basically stealing much of the traffic to and from systems in America. And the Chinese excused themselves saying it was fat finger trouble. But other people suspected they had been secretly testing a cyber nuke. Because if you were to announce that you had routes available and people believed you, or if you were to announce lots of false routes, you could break up the connectivity of the internet. And what people worried about was that when China decides to invade Taiwan, it'll switch off the internet for 2 or 3 days using a technique like this. And everybody will panic because they can't get on Facebook. And when everybody wakes up 3 days later, you know, the Chinese flag will be flying over Taipei and America will just be too late to get any warships there.
But despite these security risks, protocols can be difficult to change.
This was all designed for a cooperative world where you didn't have adversarial behaviour. And it's difficult to change these protocols because once you've got a protocol running on a billion machines from hundreds of different manufacturers, then doing any kind of upgrade is an absolute nightmare.
There's clearly a problem here. Like many protocols, BGP was made before internet use was widespread. Security was an afterthought. That leaves it open to errors and exploitation. But if one of the triumphs of the internet is that it's open to all, then who, if anyone, is looking after these protocols and making sure things don't go disastrously wrong? Emily Taylor.
The beauty of the internet being nobody is in charge and so on. The drawback of that is nobody's in charge.
One of the bodies with the most significant roles in how the internet is organised is ICANN, the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers. It's a private non-profit based in Los Angeles that coordinates something called the Domain Name System, or DNS. A domain name is something like google.com, and the Domain Name System is like an address book of those different domain names.
My name is Goran Marby. I'm the president and CEO of ICANN. So all devices around the world has a telephone number. To have a very long telephone number, you can't remember that. Let's translate that into a name. So instead of calling it blah, 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 numbers, 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 it's called BBC dot something. That is the DNS. It's the translation really from numbers, telephone numbers, into a name that people actually can remember.
This might sound incidental, but it's an essential part of how the internet works. DNS is like a common language for networks and users around the world. And along with managing the technical side, ICANN also has governance and policy responsibilities. It helps to settle disputes, as happened recently over the domain .amazon. Who owned it? The American multinational company, or the region in South America?
So the name Amazon comes from a Portuguese conquistador who came to this part of Latin South America and met a tribe of very strong female warriors. He actually named this river after using the Greek word for a strong female warrior, the Amazon. That happened 300-400 years ago. And then an American company came around. Amazon as a company saw themselves many small rivers coming into a big one, and so they named themselves Amazon as well. So who owns the word? Is there a word to be owned?
ICANN's approach to these types of problems is all about consensus.
We have a very interesting policy-making process. Literally, we bring thousands of people together from all over the world. We have active participants from 130, 140 countries who comes together through almost a parliamentary process, sets the rules for the internet. I'm the ICANN president and CEO. I'm not even allowed to participate in that process. We went through a process that actually took 7 years to come up to the answer, who owns the top-level domain .amazon. In the end, the decision was that Amazon, the company, owned it. But the thing is that nobody owns the word Amazon. Amazon is something, even in my native language, Swedish, exists, to describing a strong female warrior.
Is it a struggle running quite core functions of a network this important and this high stakes now when you need absolutely everyone to agree on everything?
I wouldn't call it a struggle in that sense. The process is set up in a way that it has to be discussions that you're taking different opinions into it. And if you don't reach a consensus, it probably wasn't a good idea in the first place.
This consensus-seeking approach is replicated by other bodies that keep the internet running. For critics, this demonstrates a sluggishness at the heart of the network. At times, the infrastructure doesn't seem to have kept pace with the internet's rapid expansion. Emily Taylor.
What Mark Zuckerberg does in his coffee break probably has more immediate global impact than what ICANN has achieved in the last two decades. Increasingly, the policy issues that are really animating people in the internet environment are not about naming and addressing. They are about cybersecurity, about the power of private platforms and social media companies, disinformation, privacy, surveillance. And ICANN doesn't really do any of those other issues. They're not central to its role. And so there is a sort of now quite a fragmented landscape of organizations and processes, and particularly intergovernmental processes that have formed because of the lack of anything else.
The internet's critical infrastructure. It's got 3 or 4 billion of us on it, and some huge parts of it are run by not-for-profits. Some parts of it are the big tech companies dealing with each other. Some parts are government to government. Like, is it as much of a mess as it sounds like?
Pretty much. I think that the technical community, who were really pioneers in the early rollout of the internet, were really keen to ensure that it just got built and that politics would stay out of it. And although ICANN has very successfully managed to avoid trying to solve absolutely every issue associated with the internet, what that's meant is that it's also become rather insular, rather inward-looking, rather confined to a set of protocols that are becoming more and more detached from ordinary users' lives.
Ever since Sputnik and the foundation of ARPANET, America has played a role in internet governance. But in 2014, President Barack Obama decided the Department of Commerce would no longer have direct oversight of ICANN. This came into effect in 2016, and it signalled a shift in the balance of the global internet. Emily Taylor.
One of the real regrets, certainly I have, as an early optimist for the internet's transformative powers, is that nobody really has clean hands anymore. Now, when we heard the revelations of Edward Snowden, they were shocking.
Edward Snowden is an American whistleblower who in 2013 gave journalists classified information revealing global mass surveillance operations undertaken by the National Security Agency.
The long-term effect was really on the moral authority of Western companies and countries to say to other authoritarian countries, no, this is how we do it. This is how we run the internet. And so that took away an awful lot of power at a very crucial moment in the internet's development. And in a way, the transition of ICANN was motivated a bit by those Snowden revelations. It was a reaction to that. But what it has done is make ICANN less relevant.
At the moment, we have one global internet. If it fragmented, we could be left with a Chinese internet, an American internet, a British one, and so on, losing our ability to connect to sites and people across the world. Not only would this divide us, it would give governments even more control over what their citizens see and say. With America taking a step back, this vacuum of authority brings a major risk. Ross Anderson.
The fault line here is that a number of countries like Russia and China and Iran and so on want extensive domestic control of communications. Now, the Chinese have gone to the trouble of building that, of creating their own infrastructure, of creating equipment suppliers such as Huawei, and creating a huge firewall that isolates them from the rest of the universe. But many other countries want to grab some slice of control without such a huge investment by using laws instead. And one way or another, this may be heading us towards a somewhat more fragmented internet than we've had up till now.
The use of law to give greater government control over the internet is something Russia and other countries have pursued. They've pushed for an international treaty for cybersecurity through the United Nations. Cindy Cohen.
The UN was structured during the politics of the post-war era, which gave Russia and China veto power over pretty much everything. I'm not sure it's the right model for the kinds of things that we need to protect on the internet. And I think that we really do need to think kind of from scratch about how we would build something that does this.
But what would starting from scratch look like? While many governments are agitating for more control, enormous multinational companies have been taking over the internet. It's not the internet itself that's interested in our data. It's the tech giants, the platforms, that collect it, commoditize it, and profit from it. Perhaps one way to combat the internet's fragmentation would be to go back to the first principles celebrated by its early pioneers. Protocols may not be an everyday topic of conversation, but they are the building blocks on which the internet is built, and they could point to a way forward. Cindy Cohen.
I do think that the things that have worked have been protocols, not platforms, setting up systems where the decision-making isn't easily controlled by either corporations or governments, and letting the science really and the technical piece work out what the protocols are, I think should be fundamental. And that needs to be an international process, and it needs to recognize all the different users around the world. And then once we've set the protocol, we don't need as much of a regulatory oversight. We still do, but I think that should be the focus, is how do we continue to make as much of the internet, talk to as much of the internet as possible in the way that it started. It's just, it's a much bigger deal now. A lot more people rely on it. And so we need to think a little bigger about how to build checks and balances into the systems.
It might mean rethinking the role of organizations like ICANN, bringing their aims more in line with the contemporary challenges we face online. Goran Marby recognises the potential of replacing the organisation of which he's CEO.
at one point in time, something better than the structure we have today will come around. And then it's time for us to be replaced. And ICANN, the technology we represent, should then be replaced, and we should go home and do something different. So that is, it has to evolve. It has to be something else.
Do you think it's getting harder to hold together the consensus or the coalition that keeps ICANN and the governance of the internet going? You know, as we start to see everyone getting more fractious.
We do see countries who closest down internet. My argument often to them when I interact with them is that, just remember that, you know, if you have export in your country, the access to your customers might be a good thing. And if you disconnect the access to your customers, that could have other effects. We truly believe that a fragmented internet is not good for people.
For those early pioneers like Steve Crocker, that's the spirit that created the internet. One of the protocols Crocker initiated, requests for comment or RFCs, is still widely used today.
I made a trip to India and gave a talk in Bangalore, and I was introduced to a graduate student who had built some fairly elaborate software, and I asked him how he had gotten all the data to do that, all the information. He said, well, I just downloaded the RFCs, read them, and built this. And I thought, wow, pretty cool. Brought tears to my eyes. The whole thing has been an amazing ride. We got into it young enough so that we're still around to see it 50 years later. Not everybody's here, but to be able to encompass a full 50 years is kind of amazing.
Platforms keep us in one place, on Facebook, in Google Drive, in the App Store. In that sense, they're like islands. Protocols, then, are like bridges or boats, keeping us connected and letting us choose where we want to go. Improving the governance of DNS or tightening the security of protocols like BGP isn't a matter of new political organisations or technical standards. It's both. They need to be accountable to the users of the internet and fit for an era where the internet is something we can't live without. If we build up protocols instead of commercial platforms, we might get closer to holding the internet together and keeping a global network that is open to all. To properly tackle disinformation, privacy, surveillance, and security, we need protocols that aren't drawn up on a pair of napkins.
That was Analysis, presented by James Ball and produced by me, Anta Dean. If you found it interesting, please do subscribe or rate us wherever you get your podcasts.